Today I'm here with Lou Clifton from the Shoe School in Newtown in Wellington. And Lou started a school to teach the craft of making shoes.
Mm-hmm.
And what prompted you to do it?
Because I really wanted to be a shoemaker. And I looked around and I could see that there weren't that many people making handmade shoes in New Zealand. And I thought, what will I do? How will I make a living out of this? And I was like, I'll start a shoe school. I'll start right back at the beginning. And I'll teach everyone how to make shoes. And that way I get to make them every day. I get to be a craftsperson, use my hands, but also I get to talk to lots of people who are super excited about making shoes. So yeah,
so
I'll never
did
be
you
bored.
Train?
I trained in Australia and Japan.
Yeah.
When I started, you could do a 3-week course as part of Otago Polytechnic, so I did do that. I enrolled an entire fashion certificate so I could do this 3-week course. And then I went to Australia and did a couple of short courses, and then I managed, just through good fortune, to go to Japan and sit with the master for a couple of months, and I've done that twice.
Right.
And then, yeah.
And he's a master teacher, or does he have a shoe brand?
He has a shoe brand called Clematis Ginza, and there's only two of them working there. One of my friend Jamie, who arranged the whole apprenticeship, and he does teach. He teaches at night. But mostly he makes bespoke shoes.
Right.
Mm.
Right. So it's an ongoing process around learning and upskilling all the time. Like, would you study with someone else?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So have you got someone that you'd like to study with?
No, I actually thought about that the other day. I was like, I should start thinking about someone or thinking about what specific gaps there are in my knowledge, because I've been to my first teacher was amazing and is still a major inspiration for me. She had a studio attached to her house, which is what I've currently got, which is awesome. And she's primarily a teacher. And then the second place I went to was a company called Stepping Out that does shoes for theatre and film. And they work quite differently. It's one person does the pattern making, one person does the designing, another person does the sewing, the heels, the insoles. So that was amazing, and it's big budget kind of stuff. And then I went to Japan and learnt with a master shoemaker, and there's just two of them, and the workshop is tiny and crammed, and but the showroom is beautiful with jazz music playing, and the shoes are worth thousands. So I've been to three quite different shoemaking businesses.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you see sort of an upsurge in that demand for crafted shoes?
Yeah, definitely. But they're quite, it's quite expensive to produce them. But I feel like Shoe School is addressing that, because the more shoemakers, the greater the demand for the suppliers, and I'm hoping that I'll be able to make all the tools and accessories and materials more accessible by selling tool kits and things like that. So
your aim is to train more craftspeople?
Yeah, and create that demand for handmade shoes.
Rather than have your own brand?
Yeah, no, I don't want to. I like it because they get to make a different pair of shoes every day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And do you make a pair of shoes every day?
I work on a different pair of shoes every day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, of course, because making a pair of shoes takes more than one day.
Yeah. So today I'm actually making a whole lot of patterns for Toi Whakare, for the costume design students. So these are some paper patterns that I've mocked up just to check that the basics are correct. So these are going to be 17th century shoes. And we're just getting some heels today, which have the nice Louis curve. Yeah. So
wow.
I've got to make
so
eight
where do you get
patterns
your heels
today.
From?
Heels, you can get them from New Zealand, from shoemaking material suppliers, but we got these particular ones. I think they were from the US. You just look online, AliExpress, and there's lots of websites selling shoemaking materials. So,
the heels themselves, are they made out of a similar?
Yeah, they are.
Is that plastic?
Yeah.
So that keeps them quite lightweight.
Yeah.
What did they used to be made out of?
Leather or wood.
Right.
Yeah.
Not having plastics and resins and
not medieval
for arts, but back in the day.
You kind of
wonder, what did they make them out of?
Interesting.
So because I saw on your social media that you did some work with
Unitech. Costume design.
And they looked incredible.
Yeah, they were amazing. Yeah, they were so cool.
And being able to offer that, are you going to teach it through universities, shoemaking, as well as your own shoemaking classes?
Yeah, so I currently teach through Massey in Wellington, through Unitech in Auckland, Ara Fashion in Christchurch, and Toi Whakaari in Wellington.
Right.
Yeah.
So how many people attend your classes?
I've got 8 students next week, which will be fun, but in my shoe school workshops, that's for the costume design, but in my workshops I normally say 4, but if I get a couple and that can be siblings or friends, then I can extend it to 6, because people normally relay the information that I've told. If I tell one person, then they'll be a friend. Yeah.
And
they kind of look after each other.
And with friends and family, do you find that they're happy to work in closer physical space to each other?
Yeah, and support each other.
Yeah. So your course is 5 days?
Yes, yeah.
So is that over 5 weekends?
No, 5 consecutive days.
Right, so you'll take leave too.
Yeah. I have considered making it an evening class, but it's quite a lot of setup involved. I'm still considering it. So a lot of gear that you have to have available for each specific student. And and it's quite intense work as well. Like, it's all consuming. Students go home really tired. So I like that you can do it in 5 days, and that's all you do for 5 days.
So you can stay really focused on that.
Yeah, it's a real experience.
And I guess if it's a learning a totally different skill, then you need that level of focus without disruption.
Yeah.
Dropping it, picking it back up,
Plus there's only one of me, so
yeah.
I've thought about, I could, teach in the day and then I could just teach in the evening. I'm like, no, wait.
If it's an intensive process, then that's a long time to be involved in it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Through the day and evenings as
well.
So, shoe fashion, because we work in textile and clothing, and the whole rise of that fast fashion, I was going to ask you if you had concerns around that with footwear.
I did that Frankenfoot, the Fringe Festival show, where I collected hundreds of shoes over 3 weeks from one op shop that were destined for landfill. So, yes, I recognise that it's, I've seen evidence that there's so many shoes that people wear for not very long and then chuck away. But I am definitely now in the world of handmade shoemaking. And so it's not, fast fashion is not something that I don't think about it anymore. My whole world is handmade shoes and craft and of mastering techniques that are hundreds of years old. So I don't think about going to and buying cheap pairs of shoes anymore.
Yeah.
Or hardly even go to shoe shops.
Well, you don't need to, do you?
I do look obsessively online, and I have massive Pinterest boards of all the shoes that I want to make, but it's now that fast fashion world is another world for me.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because that, you think nice. if our clothing consumption's increasing, then you'd assume that our footwear consumption would be increasing as well.
Yeah, I would assume so for other people, but definitely not for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't like it when you go into those cheap footwear places, the smell of the adhesives.
Yeah, it smells bad, doesn't it?
You can come out
yeah.
with a headache.
Yeah.
It's just...
Yeah, when we did Frankenfoot, I would teach people how to cut up shoes, and it's amazing the amount of foams and synthetics that are in shoes. Like, yeah.
Do you use it like a bandsaw, or how did you?
I use a craft knife and
oh, right.
scissors. Yeah, there are some things that only I can cut up, and then there are other things that I'll give a pair of scissors to someone to cut up. But
yeah.
Generally, it's just me on the craft knife.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Mostly, my sensei's clients were men. He sold about 90% of his shoes to men, and that's because there's a huge range of fashion shoes available for women, and men don't get the same choice. But I really like this style of men's shoes. I think it's quite cool. So I wanted to make a pair of shoes for me in a more masculine style, I guess. So the uppers are stitched on a machine, but everything below the sole is stitched by hand, or shaped by hand with a knife, which is also sharpened by hand. It's quite a journey. This is a leather insole, which has been formed, it's been carved into, and you keep this little strip. And then what you do is, this ridge on the edge of the shoe is called a welt that's been stitched into. So you stitch it twice. So you put the welt up against the edge of the leather insole, and using an awl, which is a pointy sticky
thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. you push a hole.
That one.
Yeah, except a curved one.
Yeah.
So it can go in and then out the other side of the welt. And that hole you then stitch up using either boar bristles or curved needles with a wax linen thread. And then once that's stitched on, so you stitch it all the way around here, not the heel, and then you flip it over, and then you're stitching the welt to the sole leather.
Right.
So
yep.
That stitch there is the visible stitch there. And you can get really fine. Like, I went for a really big stitch. I was just playing around. But if I was being a master, I would go for a tiny, tiny stitch. And I would be showing off, but I'm not really showing. I'm not that good.
Wow. So why boar?
Boar bristles?
Bristles?
I don't know. Maybe it's I do know. It's because the boar bristles slide past each other. You've got to put them in the hole at the same. There's two. There's a bit of linen thread, and on either end is a needle or a bristle, and then they go in at the same time. One goes in, and then the other one goes in, and then they get pulled out together.
Oh.
So they'll just slide past each other.
So they haven't got, like, a wool has the scales on it, and that's why wool hooks and felts. So the boar bristles,
yeah, are just are quite smooth, and
yeah.
Because even I defaulted sometimes to needles, because you had to, with the boar bristle, obviously there's no hole at the end for the thread to go through. So you have to perfect this art of wrapping the wax linen using beeswax around the end of the boar bristle, and when you're really good, you can just grab the needle and roll it on your, well, this bristle with the linen, and roll it on your knee, and then it wraps around perfectly.
Ah.
But I hadn't quite perfected that, so sometimes I would sew the boar bristle, and then you know, after a couple of hours of the thread falling off, I'd default to a needle.
So how long is a boar bristle? Because I think of them like with paintbrushes.
Yeah, I can show you if you like. They're about that big. I've got a
right.
whole lot of boar bristles in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is a piece of beeswax.
And you see where it's been scored
yeah.
by the thread.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. And so these are boar bristles. Needles.
And here are some.
They're almost like a fishing line, aren't they?
Yeah, so that's some.
See them. And they're really, they're really coarse.
Yeah. Well, so that's the needle that I was using instead, and you can feel that it's gotten quite rough. And then it's kind of manky now, but it's okay. Shoemaking is pretty dirty. So that's some boar bristles with some wax linen thread that's been rolled around it.
Incredible that the boar bristle is still
current.
What you use. It's amazing.
Know.
I think that nothing has changed in how many hundreds of years.
Yeah, well, actually, these ones. Because I went home, so that's what I learned in Japan, and then I went home and I thought, oh, now I have to get hold of boar bristles. But these ones were gifted to me by a fellow whose father was from the Shetland Islands, where they're quite self-sufficient, and his father made all of the family shoes. So yeah, these are his.
Right.
Yeah. So I mean, yeah.
Are they easy? Is it easy to find, or do you have to?
I haven't, but and I've had some friends who have set them the task to find me some boar bristles, and they haven't been able to come up with any. But who knows? It might be one of those things that next week I might find someone that's got a supply of boar bristles for me.
Right.
I just never know.
Yeah. So let's call out if anyone's got boar bristles.
Yeah.
So do people that attend your class, do they get a certificate?
I know.
Or use shoes as a certificate?
Yeah. I did think about making a certificate, but then I was like, oh no, I think, yeah, your shoes are a big enough gift. And I wrap them up in tissue paper. But some people don't want them wrapped up in tissue paper because they just want to go home and stare at them.
Yeah. Or get on the street with them.
Yeah.
So when you're out in town, do you see your shoes, not your shoes, but the shoes that have been worn in your workshop, do you see them walking around town?
Yeah, and it's so exciting. Yeah, I love that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's great. And I can't stop staring at them.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah, because you spend 5 days with them and then they're gone.
So when people come in to the shoe school, they have an idea of what they want to make before they come?
Yeah, so I give them 5 simple styles to choose from, and you can do a boot or a shoe, and then I get them to send me pictures of the kind of shoes that they like in that style, and so I do get people to narrow it down quite a lot, but there's also room for design on the first day. So when you turn up, you've got patterns and you've got a mock-up there, so you can start visualising it immediately. And on that first day, you choose all of your leather and your findings, like your buckles and things like that, and your soling options. And then we modify the mock-up, because people always think of new things, like once they're presented with the leather, and a little bit of time to properly think about it, things always change.
Yeah. So do you have a buckle drawer?
I have lots of buckles. So all the drawers there are buckles and eyelets and rivets.
Well, can I have a peek in
it? Yeah, sure. Some sweet little buckles that you can rivet on, which is quite a nice look.
Oh, they are cute.
Yeah, they are cute. And then these are cool. They're like the end of sort of Western style boot straps. But lots of people like those. I really like those. Little love hearts.
Ha.
Yeah. What else have we got? Oh, these things for the top of like hiking boots.
Oh, yeah.
Lots of different rivets. These are quite cool. I got these from Hong Kong. Work boot style eyelets, which I really like. Yeah, and then everything comes in a different range of colours. I dropped this the other day.
Oh, so. No!
While people were designing their shoes, I just patiently had some tweezers and put it all in, back in the right compartment.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Louise.
You're welcome.
It's fascinating hearing about it.
Yeah.
And so if anyone's walking up Riddiford Street in Newtown, We'll walk right past the glass windows,
yep,
and see the workshops happening.
Yeah, it's a nice big fishbowl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.